All right, folks. Oh, man. The next gentleman I'm going to talk to, I call him a man to respect. And I don't know whether to call this guy, should I call him the Larry King of Africa, or should I call him the Farid Zakaria, or David Frost, or, Jerry Paxman? I mean, I'm talking about the league, the top league of journalists, man. This man, Ghana, no champion, man. I have the privilege and the honor to introduce him. So put your hands together, show some love like you've never done before for Mr. Paul Adom Otchere. Hola. Paulus.
Hello, sir.
Oh, sir? Me, I forgot you, sir. But it's good to have you here. We're going to take a small commercial break. When we come back, Paul is in the house. We'll be right back.
It's going to get sweeter than guinea fowl. It's the KSM show.
The KSM show.
Paul, welcome to the show, man.
Thank you very much.
It's good to have you here, man.
Good to see you.
I feel almost honored to have you on this, on the side of this.
It's my great
interaction.
It's my great pleasure to be here.
So how are you doing? You're flying these days, so man.
We thank God for that.
But I like how your focus. I like your how you stuck to it. You know, because no matter what the distractions are, you have kept your focus on building yourself as a top journalist.
Well, it's something that I liked, and I got in by accident, and as you know, the story of all of the people of my generation, universities go on strike, you have nothing to do, you go hang around Radio Universe, and later on you get noticed, in my case, by KKD, and then Tommy and Alforsen.
They noticed you?
Yeah, so they sent me to Choice, which was Sunshine.
Sunshine,
and
yeah.
1 week after we got in, it became Choice, and KKD left, and Tommy handled us. Later on, I got noticed by Samens at Joy FM. Then Bafo Bonny of Radio Gold fell in love with me, you know. And so that's how the
that's
story
how
has been.
The story been yeah.
At some point after the big election of 2000, I went out for a stint with the BBC by the Joy FM channel, and I decided to sort of go back to school and study. And then so television in the night was more useful to me because I couldn't work in the morning. And then in comes Talal Fatah with open arms, willing to offer me an opportunity.
To do the night TV.
Yeah, and a TV station that hitherto did not do anything about news. You know, Metro is called the Metropolitan Entertainment Television. And so it was an entertainment television until 2001 when Talal Fatah and the board felt that they should do something about news. And so there's a guy there called Ezra Setchere, and I doffed my hat to him. He said to Talal that this guy on Joy FM can do it. So I went in and we struggled over many names for a current affairs program, and Talal said we should call it Good Evening Ghana. So we did. It was supposed to start at 7:15, and that's how the first episode started.
7:15?
Yeah, the very first episode, which was aired live in about July 2001, was between... The guests were Pakwesi Indum.
Wow, that's your first guest?
That's my first guest. Pakwesi Indum and the late Edward Salia.
Wow.
Because Edward Salia was then the Minister of Communication.
Okay.
And the MPP had just taken over power. He was an outgone Minister of Communication. The MPP had just taken power. And there was a whole big issue about Telecom Malaysia. Some Malaysians had come in and they had bought Ghana Telecom, something like that. So that was our first issue. The program was supposed to run for 15 minutes because Metro didn't want to turn itself into a current affairs. So after 15 minutes of the show, Talal, who was executive producer on the floor, said we should go on. Then we went on for 1.5 hours. That was the first episode. So we had to come rethink about what we do with this program. And the next morning we got people saying, yeah, we saw the show and this was good. Was it a show they saw? They saw something like that, no? So as people were calling Talal and telling him they've heard something about some show, he decided that they should repeat the show right there and then.
Wow.
So he called the studios about 10 past 8 and said, put on
the
last
show.
Night's thing again. You know, and as they say, the rest is history. So
wow.
So that's how it became. So that gave me that opportunity to do. But I got back into radio because eventually CTFM came around and I was part
You started that news, was 5:30 News? Was
yeah, it's called the Eyewitness
News. Eyewitness News, yes.
It was actually a name chosen by Samen as well. Nick Amatefio, who is the owner of CTFM. Mm-hmm. And who was very close friends with Kofor and was a big person in Kofor's administration, thought about getting a television license, you know. And I think you are a better part of that story, KSM, you know. So we won't say all of that. But then he didn't get a television license and he wanted radio because he had come from America and so he wanted radio. So 97.3, we took it from you and then we just put it out there. And so he wanted a station that could do very well. Mm. So he spoke to me about leading and I said, well, my boss at Joy FM, who I think still has some radio in him, is now selling Coca-Cola all over the place. He's in Liberia, he's in Cameroon, he's in Cote d'Ivoire. He's working as a top executive of Coca-Cola. Maybe he would like radio again. So I called him. He was actually in Liberia, you know, and he said, am I serious about it? I said, yeah, it's a radio opportunity. We can do it. So he came, took over.
Wow.
We went to the University of Ghana and we stood there, looked at the boys coming up and down, went to Radio Universe and just took some people and said, come, let's do an auditioning. So then came Bernard Avila and a lot of the boys who, most of whom went back to school to become lawyers. But we recruited fundamentally from Lagos.
Hmm.
And we picked up a few guys from GIJ as well. Put them together and we decided to do a full news station. So that's how CTFM started. And I still kept Good Evening Ghana, by the way, because the guys we recruited were quite competent. They were able to manage the situation. So Good Evening Ghana this year is calling itself 15 years old. You know, that's how long it's been. Of the 15 years, I've been away for 1.5 years. I went abroad to study. And when I went away, a few people did the program. Anaya Ofoyata is one of them. Egbert Febil did it as well. Eventually, Charles Sam.
Charles Sam did.
Yes. I was away for a whole year and a half. Yeah. So Charles Sam held it for a bit.
Mm.
And so I came back, took over, and then we continued again. So really, that's a story. And
you deeply rooted in, should I call it, the recent, modern, you know, journalistic trends in Ghana. You're deeply rooted. Since we went from the state-owned radio to private,
you know,
you have a very strong history then.
And I've been following, yes. I've been engaged with it. I've entangled myself with it.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm excited about the new epoch, which is the digital migration, which hopefully should make things much, much better.
Mm-hmm.
My desire is to see people leave the university with top grades and be able to come into media as it was by the towards the end of the 20th century, 1999, 2000. It used to be like that. But now the banks came, took over and took our people and all of that. I'm hoping for the day when people will come back.
Mm. What made you stay? Because like you said, the banks came and took the people. Mm. And when I think about the pool of people that started then,
Everyone is gone.
Everyone is gone.
Yeah.
What made you stay?
I'm still here. I think basically I like the job. I managed to go back to school in many different dimensions, so I am able to squeeze in other things to do and also maximize the opportunities that the job can give. And I've also taken a personal crusade that in my lifetime, I will see the restoration of media practice as a top job in Ghana.
Amen. Show some love, man. I love that.
I travel around and I see that media is top everywhere. So I began to research into why Ghana is so. And I blame the colonial masters for it.
Hmm.
So I found a story in my research that when people want to become doctors and they're leaving secondary school, the medical school is requiring the top grades of them.
Mm-hmm.
When people want to become lawyers, they are requiring the top grades of them.
Mm.
Even in the old days, when you wanted to become a priest, an Orthodox priest,
they
are required to get the top grades.
Mm.
But when you wanted to become a journalist, there was no such requirement.
Mm.
And I look at a colonial master's country, and it's not the case.
Mm.
You go to England and America and France and all of those places, the requirements for studying journalism is the same requirements for studying medicine and law and all of that. So I then go on to think, why did the colonial master make it so? Then I realized that he saw the media as a tool for control. And so he didn't want the media practitioners to be such independent-minded as to remove his control.
Mm.
Then I noticed that his first level of battle in colonial Ghana was against people who had come with good education, like Kwame Nkrumah and co, who set up newspapers, the evening news and all of that. But then comes my disappointment. So the colonial authority is gone. The local authority takes over, Nkrumah and co, and they sort of maintain the status quo when it comes to journalism.
They didn't upgrade
so
the levels.
So typically when I started news reporting, that's basically what I am, a news reporter. When I started news reporting, I attended one event, the University of Ghana congregation. Ivan Adai Mensah had just taken over as vice chancellor. So I brought my report to the newsroom, and I headlined what Ivan Adai Mensah said. Then the news editor, who had been trained with the established institutions of journalism, said to me, was the Minister of Education not there? I said, yeah, he was there. He said, but why don't you headline what he says? I said, but why? This is the University of Ghana's congregation. Yeah, this is Ivan Adaimensah, the new vice chancellor. What he says is, he said, no, that's not what you do, Paul. You have a lot of talent, but let me show you. First, the minister.
Wow.
If the president is there, him, vice president, minister. Was there any other minister?
Before you can get to anybody else.
Before you get to anybody else. So over time, so I took her instructions nonetheless. But over time, I realized that this is a relic of the colonial administration. Mm-hmm. So this is how they prepared our journalists to think. Mm-hmm. So that's what I mean by, in my lifetime, I'd like to see journalism restored as a top job in Ghana.
I love you, man. Kill them, man. And you're so right. You're so right, you know.
If we fix journalism, we will fix the politics. We will fix the roads. We will fix everything. Mm. Because the reason why our country suffers is because the people who are telling the story either don't have the competence, the capacity, or they don't, just don't have the effrontery and the resources to tell it. Mm. So you're going to have 29,000 polling stations around the country on the 7th of December. No media house will be able to cover 29,000 polling stations. Yeah. No media house has helicopter. No media house has anything. But you can't, the American elections will be fairer. The British elections will be fairer because the media can cover it. And they are independent. And they are well-resourced. And so you can't do certain things. Mm-hmm. Ghana has come the way we have come because of even the media that we call fragile. Now, when I went to Ivory Coast to interview Laurent Gbagbo, which was one of my big interviews in this career, he was then president of La Côte d'Ivoire, and the elections had gone bad. Then we found the problem in Ivory Coast. And among ourselves, the Ghanaian journalists who went for this event, we were laughing at the Ivorians because they don't have any private radio station. This is 2013. Ivory Coast has no private radio station. So the election results is broadcast by the state broadcaster. Mm. So when we went to discuss with their media that, let's understand your dispute. So where did the results come from? They said it came from the UN. We said UN? They said yes. So Lasani Ouattara took his results from the UN, and Gbagbo took his results from some electoral commission. So okay, what did the media say? They don't have any media.
Wow.
We said, oh, wow. The private radio, no. Private TV, no. We said, then you're going to have these kind of elections.
Yeah.
So we were excited about our country. And if you take it further, that is what that the difference between Britain and Ghana in terms of elections and in terms of good governance is the media. And the colonial master didn't want that to happen.
Mm.
He was not interested in good governance. Mm. So he was interested in lawyers who he can use to do something. He was interested in doctors who take care of their children. But the media, he didn't.
No, but you're so on point, you know, to get that kind of media that you don't invite to a small set, you know, and then they are waiting for item 13 so that you can give them a small envelope. How can you not influence such a media?
I mean, it's interesting. And I read the books. I'm currently reading a book about David Foster. It's interesting. I read books about British media, and there was a big incident when Prime Minister Tony Blair, he called the Sky News and said to them that he was in the heat of the Iraq advocacy to take soldiers to Iraq. He said they were holding a conference in Europe, the European Union. He wanted to go along with one Sky reporter. And Sky said, sorry, we'll be there.
Hmm.
And he said, oh, but I'm going with my plane. He said, we have a plane, we'll be there.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
And I read that. I said, this must happen in Ghana. So the president has his presidential press corps. So the president is going to Cape Coast to go and campaign. And Metro TV will be calling the president to say, no, we shouldn't do that.
Yeah.
We should call Cape Coast, book our hotel, have our helicopter, have our drones.
Yeah.
And he calls me, are you going to be there? Yeah, don't worry about that. We'll be there. Who is coming? Don't worry. We'll be there.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then we can show the things we have. Yeah. But the media must be resourced to do that. And I think politicians don't really like that, you know, because when the media is not resourced, you know, you can get away with a lot.
There's a dependency thing there.
Yes. And then you can give them item 13 and get away with quite a bit, you know. But when the media is sufficiently resourced, they'll be able to tell the story. The relationship between media and politics will be better.
Mm-hmm.
It will also expose politics so much that only people who feel qualified and competent will do it.
Mm-hmm.
Because you will know that if you go and do it and you don't do it right, you'll be exposed.
Mm-hmm.
And so you won't do it. But that day is coming. I believe it's coming very soon. I believe 2016 may be the last election that we will do without all of these things I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. By the time we get to the next election, we should be there. Mm-hmm. And
Show some love, man. I really appreciate that you stick to it, because I was having a good conversation with Kwame Dumont, may he rest in peace. And he said he would tell people, oh, I'm in radio, I'm in news. They say, so what do you eventually want to become?
Yeah.
Do.
Yeah.
Yeah. So people were even seeing it as an interim thing. You can't take journalism serious.
It was you interim know. When we're there.
So I like it to see that you are focused on making it the thing.
I'll be there.
Yeah, you are there,
I'm
man.
I'm here. I'm not going nowhere.
How difficult was it to get your last interview with the president? Have you got to that point yet that he hears that you have called and said, let put him through?
Now, that request to interview the president is always on his doorstep. And it's on his doorstep from us, from any other people.
Yeah.
And so the Flagstaff House people will be monitoring and making their choices and decisions. Mm. In 2014, we got one. And so we had been knocking at the doors in the beginning of the year that we wanted another one. And so often, eventually, they might call you. And so 2 months ago, so I interviewed Dr. Amani Boama on the launch of their campaign. And so I asked the chief, my request is still pending with the old man. He said, we're looking at it, you know. Mm-hmm. So he called and said, okay, which areas would you like to discuss with the old man? I said, oh, so I sent him some areas. He looked at it, he called and said, okay, some of your areas, we need to discuss it. And then eventually they said I should be ready for a short notice. So short notice, they called and said, okay, the old man will give you an interview. I said, thank God, that's the sign of the cross. You know? So I went in and then we looked at the areas and here he was. Yeah. And we put the questions to him. And after that, we had a nice chat. And we're happy with it. Of course, people in the society will have their different opinions.
Yeah.
But there was a big concern on Twitter about the suggestion that the president has seen the questions. Right. And I have to say that when you are interviewing the president, you give him the areas. So,
yeah.
Because he has to prepare for it. So, yes, the president knew the themes and the areas on which the questions will be based.
But not
The follow-up questions, I myself didn't know what the follow-up questions will be. As the conversation goes on, the follow-up questions comes. But in terms of the areas, yes, he knew. I told him, and you are required to tell them. Mm-hmm. And it's standard practice all over the world. Mm-hmm. People were also worried why the interview was not a live interview. And I had pointed them to the interview of Farid Zakai with Barack Obama the week before. It was not live. Because these kinds of people, presidents, they don't represent themselves. They represent a whole country. And so when they're going for an interview everywhere in the world, there's a lot of protectionism from their people. Mm-hmm. But they also have a responsibility to govern transparently. So they opened up themselves for the interview. Live interviews can be discomforting. And because the man doesn't represent himself, you'd always grant him that. The American president is granted that. And so the Ghanaian president will be granted that. So apart from that, we believe that we ask all the relevant questions. We had an opportunity of an hour to do it. Mm-hmm. We think we thought the big issues would be why he released the Moon Tier 3, whether he had taken a bribe in a Ford car gift, and we put those questions across. People were getting concerned at the time that he was attacking his opponent, so we put that to him as well. And then we had a few pedestrian questions about his wife, Lodina, and that kind of thing.
Whether
the JJ thing, and JJ took the boom and all of that. So those were all the issues.
It was a great interview, by the way. I loved it.
Thank you.
I loved it, man. Oh, man. Well, Charlie, you're the man, man.
You're the man.
You're the man. And your family, man. I know we've been talking journalism and everything. How do you relax, man? What are your hobbies?
Ah, well, that's interesting. My hobbies, I just like talking.
Oh, talking?
Yeah. A year and a half ago, I put on too much weight and the doctor said I was going to die. So.
Oh, really?
So I decided to get exercising regularly. So that sort of has become my hobby as well.
Okay,
so I went to play tennis with some people at Novotel and I walk on the road all the time. So I'm enjoying that. So I've been doing that for a year and a half and that's great. But I watch football.
You watch football?
I'm very much into football. Mm. And watch television. I watch television a lot. I watch news
on
television a lot. And I tell all my colleagues that because we're in this business, let's watch television and we'll get the standards. So my hobbies are varied. I do everything and anything.
And any particular anchor person that you love that you really think their delivery and everything is spot on, or
In terms of the news.
The news, yeah.
Ooh, yeah, a lot of them. I mean, quite a few people.
Yeah.
So Larry King was always, was always one of those.
Yeah.
Because I like Larry King because he was particularly wealthy, you know.
Yeah. You are wealthy too, Paul. I'm head, man.
We'll get there.
The word around is like Charlie Paul.
Oh no, we'll get there. We'll get there.
Now talk about what about Ghana scene? News.
Oh, the Ghanaian scene, the news anchors.
Yeah.
They come and they leave. They leave quickly, but I've seen some on TV3 that I thought are very, very good. Mm. Israelai is now on multi TV, so I don't see him often. Yeah. But he was one of those who did well. Yeah. And on radio, there are people who I like.
Who would you say needs work?
needs work on. Mm. There are a lot more of them. that all of us started. I read television news as well.
Yeah.
On TV3 many, many years
oh,
ago.
Oh, really? You on TV3?
Yes, I was on TV3 in 1998.
Oh, wow.
Befia Penton. I had gone to TV3.
Okay.
I started out as a sports reporter. So TV3 were doing the 1998 World Cup. And that was their first World Cup. And so they wanted to show people that they could do it. GBC then used to have the monopoly of a World Cup. So GBC's panel was always standard. Moses Fuamoni, Kwabena Eboa, Papa Pintel, standard. So TV3 said they wanted younger people, much, much younger, 20-year-olds.
Yeah.
So they came to pick us. So myself, Yohan Pofuankra, Fifi Banson. So we did the World Cup with Coach Samade and others for TV3. So whilst I was doing the World Cup, Befia Pintel asked me whether I didn't want to read news. First, he asked, what year are you in? I said, I'm in second year in the university. He said, would you like to read news? I said, maybe. He said, after the World Cup, come and talk to me. He was then the manager of TV.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I went to see Befia and said, I want you to read news because I think you have the voice for it. So I started. And it was an interesting time in TV3 because there was just about five of us, myself, Emma Morrison, Amada Day, and somebody like that. Now, this is how it was. The 7 o'clock news bulletin was the prime one. So every month, they'll give us a schedule. I was the youngest, so I don't get a lot of 7 o'clocks, maybe twice in a month. That didn't bother me because they paid us per the news. And the late news was 10:30.
Mm.
A lot of these guys, especially the girls, they didn't want the 10:30, so they hand over to me. So I get paid for it.
Mm.
So I will crash on all the 10:30 news throughout the month. And by the time I get back to school at the end of the month, I have
you're,
a lot
you're
of
okay.
points. I was cool. I was very good. So yeah, so I read news, and every now and then the Malaysian guy Azmin, whose principles he taught me, I still use them. Azmi will call me back to his office and say, let's go through the news again.
Mm.
Azmi Atan, I don't even know where he is now. Brilliant guy. He was about 27 years old. And he came to be the director of TV3. And Yohan Pofuankra and I have very fond memories of him because he was our great friend. He was unmarried, so he would go out with us and he would learn how to speak Chui and he wants to meet some girls and that kind of thing. Yeah. So you know, we went and then Azmi would tell me, okay, let's take this paragraph. And he would teach me how to do it.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
He would teach me how to put emotions in. He would teach me how to take the emotions out. He would teach me how to lift up my voice. And I had a lot of work. He did a lot of work on me. And I'm still great. Wherever he is, I say thank you to him.
Wow. Fantastic. Finally, the wife, you
know, okay, I'm married. Yeah.
Yes. And how many kids?
I have kids. But I'm still married to the lady that I got married to.
Yeah, yeah.
There had been some rumors in town every now and then.
Oh, really? No.
Especially because I don't wear my ring.
Okay.
It's because I don't like ornaments. And I hardly wear wristwatches, but because I'm coming here, I want to show off the ring. But yes, she's called Beryl, and we're married now for 10 years.
Great.
So,
Beryl is watching. Bigger Beryl for him. man, I thank you so much.
No, it's
man.
A pleasure.
I wanted
pleasure,
to KSM. Hang out with you, man, because I'm very, very impressed with your moves, man.
I want
your
to
moves,
hang out with
man.
You more. I mean,
yeah.
Because you came to Ghana and you revolutionized everything, you know, and we were on university campus when we had this guy on radio and he calls everybody fools. I wonder what kind of madness is that. Who's this guy?
Who's this
from America and he's calling people. There's a big debate about you in Lagos, whether you're American or you're Ghanaian.
Really?
Yeah. And thankfully, we had a mentor in Nana Bedie too. So
yeah.
We went to his office and he had a big laugh. He tried to call you. He didn't get you.
Oh,
said,
really?
You're his brother. You're Ghanaian. Very Ghanaian, you know. And we're excited to see the new breath of fresh air that you brought. My disappointment is that Vibe FM didn't survive because that was a very powerful amalgamation of liberated minds.
Yeah,
I mean, that Michael Cook and all
Michael
the guys.
Cook
I mean,
and the guy.
And that was Talal Fatal's favorite station, Vibe FM.
Really?
Yeah, I mean, when we heard Vibe FM, you could, I mean, these were the minds who were liberated. Yeah. And when Komla and I spoke, we would make jokes about the accent of people on Vibe FM.
Yeah.
But we always listened. And where is everybody? Cindy?
Cindy's in the UK.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she Michael went back Cook? To the UK. Mike is around here somewhere, man.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, okay, he's
just
in
around
town.
The corner. Yeah, he's in town. Yeah.
But
he's
KSM town. Is here.
I'm here, man. Show him some love, man. Show him some love. And you're doing great, man. And
Thank you, sir.
When I watch you, I get that feeling, you know. I used to do the TED couple things and, you know, late night and heavy, deep journalist talk, qualified, brilliant. And that's you, man.
Thank you.
So keep it up.
Thank you, sir.
Keep it up. Show your love one more time. And I'll see you soon, man.
Soon?
Yeah.
Let it be soon, KSM.
It will be soon.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks.
Stick around, folks. Paul Adom Otchere in the house. We will be right back.
If you're having as much fun as I am, stay tuned. If you're not, you need deliverance. We'll be right back.
KSM Show.